Well, good evening and welcome to the Tuesday, April 27th, 2021 regular meeting of the Windham Southeast School District Board. Call us to order at 6:02 p.m. And before we proceed with the agenda, I'd like to recognize Tim Maciel for a moment. Tim, are you ready?
Okay, thank you, David. As most of you know, on April 10th, Tom Young passed away. He's an extraordinary person. So I have a motion to honor his legacy to our district. Whereas Thomas C. Yon of Brattleboro, a veteran educator who directed the Windham Regional Collegiate High School, a dual enrollment program that enabled high school students to earn college credit and that became a model for similar programs across Vermont. Whereas Thomas Yon's lifelong service as a mentor, along with his devotion and his great success in inspiring students to seek innovative alternative entryways to learning, ways that valued their experiences and abilities and that tore down barriers of class, financial hardship, and academic traditions. And whereas Thomas Yon's educational philosophy, one that respected the role of the student as an active learner, one that demonstrated the power of student-centered teaching, and one that inspired countless others, whereas his love of Vermont and his life of great integrity, commitment, humanity, and friendship have inspired us all. Therefore, be it resolved that the Windham Southeast Supervisory District recognizes the extraordinary contributions of Thomas C. Yon, mourns his passing, and extends sincerest condolences to his wife, Ann Fielder, and to other surviving members, friends, and former students.
Thank you, Tim. Tim has introduced a resolution honoring Thomas Yon. I'd like to call for a vote of the board on this. All those in favor, please unmute and indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
And any opposed?
Did that have to be seconded?
No.
Okay.
Hearing none. The motion or the honor, the resolution is passed. Thank you, Tim. I did see a couple of hands there. Wendy, did you have a question?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. It's already been answered.
Okay, great, great, thank you. Okay, so thank you, Tim. So now we'll move on to the consent agenda. We have the minutes of April 6, 2021 to approve. Could I have a motion to that effect, please?
So moved.
Thank you, Thomas. Second? Thank you, Liz. Moved and seconded to approve the minutes of April 6, 2021. All those in favor, please unmute.
Aye.
Aye. And any opposed? Hearing none, the minutes are approved. The next is public comment on non-agenda items. This is a new scheduling process that we've taken so that we can identify how many people there are and what some of the topics are that people wish to talk about. If it takes more than 10 minutes at the beginning of the meeting, then we take it up at the end of the meeting, which can sometimes be really late. So agendas, items that are not on the agenda. So if you're asking an administrator or a board member about something and they haven't had time to prepare an answer or look into the background of the issue, you're probably not going to get an answer. But we do note that, and we also encourage people to write to us or call. So having said all that, are there any items that are not on the agenda that members of the public would like to speak to? Seeing none, we will move on to the administrative reports. And the first is a hiring report from Andy.
Okay, so we have a handful of new hires this evening.
We have been receiving a number of applicants this year. We had worked on a direct list. I can't tell you what the number of applicants we have this evening, how many applicants were in each of the pool for many of these positions, if they were larger pools. So with two of the positions we have at Academy, there were 9 and 12 candidates applying. For the two, for the position at BUHS, there were 3 applicants in the pool. With the pool in Dummerston, for the position we're looking to hire, there were 7. For the position in Putney, and I'll share all these names in a minute, there were 16 candidates. And then the Career Center has 3 has applicants in their pool for their positions as well. And so we're fortunate to be able to extend that. With the other positions that are that we're still looking to fill are still open. So I wouldn't be able to give you a total in terms of what those were. There are a handful of openings that are still out there. BAMS is still looking to fill an English, a language arts role, as well as an instructional coach position. BAMS is looking to fill a long-term PE sub. BUHS is looking to fill an instructional coach, as well as a Spanish classroom, a student engagement coordinator, which we'll talk about in a second, an academic support position at Dummerston, which we will be looking for tonight, as well as a kindergarten posting. And so within all of these positions, the nice, and there are more throughout the other schools. Green Street is looking to hire an elementary position, as well as an academic support position and another elementary position. There are a number of applicants within the pools. And so as we look through the number of openings, we're seeing double-digit candidates out there. Stacey Musso, our HR director for the SU, has been reaching out to going beyond just School Spring. So she's using Indeed as well as Handshake to extend the reach of the organization in terms of where we're finding candidates. And we're finding really, really strong candidates in all of the applications. So that's very good. I hope to have, once we finish the hiring season, to have a comprehensive list of the number of candidates for each of these positions that we've looked at, to be able to share just, you know, how any differences that we've seen thus far, where we're the kind of the concerns we had about many of these harder to fill positions, those positions haven't closed yet, but we're even seeing some people in those applying for those harder to fill roles.
And Andy, do we has the due date for teachers returning their contracts and their intention to return, has that passed, or will we potentially get more openings?
We may have more openings. I do have 3 resignations to share tonight that are going to create some openings. The contracts for teachers are going out this week. We're about a week behind on getting those out, and that's newness in central office and making sure that we have systems in place. So those contracts will go out this week. So we may see a few more openings coming up. I know that there are a couple more resignations that have not been indicated yet tonight that have been shared with principals as a conversational piece, but not necessarily as an official resignation yet. So there's a couple that we don't have in hand yet. I would put forward the following names for accepting resignations. Shannon Ward is not returning next year to Green Street. That's a grade 3 position. Leah Toffolon is resigning her position as the middle school social studies teacher at Putney Central School, effective the end of the year. And Matthew Wright is resigning his position as a school nurse at Academy School. So I'd put forward their names to accept the resignations with regret and best wishes and thanks for their serving of WSESD.
Thank you, Andy. Could I have a motion, please, to accept with regret the resignation of Shannon Ward from Green Street, Leah Toffolon from Putney Central, and Matthew Wright from Academy School?
So moved.
Seconded.
Thank you, Ann. Second, please. Thank you, Thomas. Moved and seconded to accept the resignations as presented. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye. Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, the retirements are accepted.
So I have some new hires I'd like to propose. These are the great news we get to share. So we get the tough news out of the way first. I'd like to propose that we hire Julio Ochoz as a second grade teacher at Academy School. Jeremy Kellett will be serving as a 1-year music position at Academy School. Aaron Robinson as a health position at BOHS. That's a full-time health position. That's not a 1-year, I'm sorry. Anita Bassett as an academic support teacher at Dummerston. Emily Corey as a middle grade science teacher at Putney Central School. William Savigny as an electrical teacher at the Career Center. Elizabeth Steele as a health teacher at the Career Center. And Jean Hodson as a health sciences teacher at the Career Center.
Thank you. Could I have a motion, please, to accept the employment of Julia Wilchos for Academy School, Jeremy Kellett at Academy School for a 1-year position, Aaron Robinson at BUHS, Anna Bassett at Dummerston, Emily Corey for Putney Central, William Savigny for the Career Center, and Elizabeth Steele for the Career Center, and also Jean Hodson for employment at the Career Center. Can I have a motion to approve those new hires, please?
So moved.
Thank you, Michelle. And second?
Second.
Thank you, Ann. Moved and seconded to accept the 8 new employees as presented. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Any opposed? Hearing none, the new hires are accepted. And Andy, I'd like you to ask that you hold the student engagement coordinator position. And I just got this afternoon. Yeah. It's one of those classic surprises that I really haven't had time to read through carefully, but I'd like to talk to you about it first.
Yep, we'll hold off on that one.
Great, thank you. We can do it really quickly. It's convenient. Great, thank you.
So the next topic on it was, I have Deb Cardane is with us, and Deb, if you can share a few. Deb is helping coordinate the recovery planning right now while we're developing the position for the full-time recovery coordinator, which will be run through the SU. And so Deb is taking on the challenge of corralling everyone and is doing a masterful job at that. So Deb, I'll give you a couple of moments to share kind of a 30,000 foot overview of where we are with things and the process that you've started to do that work.
Sure, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, successfully unmuted. I'm gonna share quick a few slides just to give a visual and an overview. Are you seeing slides?
I'm seeing you in the corner. So I think you need to put it up first. It's just a black screen at this point.
Yeah, let's try that again. Always fun. Let's see. How's that?
That looks good.
Okay, so quick overview. I just want to give you a little sense of the process that we're working on right now and then a couple goals that we've set. We are at this moment in the midst of the work. So we started out with leadership recovery teams. Those began with a needs assessment, and we looked at data together, and there are 2 recovery teams at this point, one for secondary and one for elementary, and those 2 groups did some good work looking at our needs and identified some areas, and they found some goals, and I'll share those with you real quick, and that information has then gone to community advisory team. That team is made up of a handful of people in leadership roles in our schools, also some teachers, some community members, some parents. We really sought to get a pretty wide range of stakeholders in that group. So the leadership recovery teams passed goals on to the community advisory team. We've met once, and that was a before break. We're meeting again this week. So they're continuing to add ideas and thinking to the goals that were established. And then their next task will be to consider how to get broader feedback from the community. So they'll, after this week, put something out to a wider range of stakeholders, which will then get information back to the leadership recovery teams and the community advisory teams to incorporate that. Once we have a plan, we'll bring it to you and send it off to the AOE. So that's kind of an overview of the process, and some of the areas that we've identified needs in include instruction. So we've really, we're looking toward integrating social emotional learning and equity inclusion practices, trauma-informed practices within a focus on student engagement. And we're really thinking about how to incorporate professional development that's embedded in our practice and allows for a lot of collaboration amongst our coaches and our teachers. We're looking to improve our data system so that data is more accessible to our teachers and to us. So these were all needs that we identified, really looking at hoping to close gaps for students. And we're also considering ways that we can do a fair amount of outreach, collaborate with our outside agencies, engage families. And then we're also working hard right now to establish plans for summer experiences for kids and really focusing on a combination of fun and learning. So there's the 30,000 foot view.
Great. We'll look forward to some details as time goes by.
Surely.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So the next topic we'll touch on briefly. I had a conversation with Mary Gannon and Dottie Morris to start that initial work around planning for the work we discussed. We have an initial set of dates that would begin at the end of August. I'll put all those details, you know, in the dates would start at the end of August, and we'd look at a collaborative meeting to start. And so I'll put all those dates onto a timeline for everyone once we finalize the full range of dates with Dottie and Mary. There were a couple of dates I had to solidify with that, but the idea is that we would have one collaborative meeting of about 3 hours long, and then we would break up the sessions through September and October. So we would start end of August with the work and end at the latter part of October for this work. And so we've been emailing back and forth. So we've had a couple of conversations on the topic around what we're looking to accomplish with the work and the group setup. And then, so as soon as we firm up the dates, we'll let everyone know. We put dates on calendars, kind of roughly penciled them in. And then we will notify all parties involved around what that training will look like. So we've moved forward. The time frame between the sessions should allow for enough kind of thinking and unpacking and reflective opportunities for people to contemplate what would go on in the next meeting. So
thank you.
Yep. And the end of the year plans are still in the works. That we're just starting to receive clarification around what the requirements will be around things like graduation and other end of the year events, sixth and eighth grade promotional activities. I know some of those conversations have started to take place at the schools as this information is transitioning. Much of the work that we're starting to see, or much of the guidance that we're starting to see, is going from the school specific to more of a universal type of guidance that would be conducted through the Vermont Forward Plan. And that work is really targeted and aligned with specific vaccination rates. And so one of the things that Vermont is doing that's unique is identifying the size of crowds and the size of groups that go along with community vaccination rates. So the initial thoughts that we're seeing around allowing outdoor graduations is that they're being encouraged to do so, and that information started to come out from the Agency of Education. So that information will be available shortly. I would ask the board to entertain a motion to allow us to have a half day of school for students on the last day of school. And so I would ask for permission to be able to do that. The last day we do know right now, because we had a remote day of learning on the day before vacation. The last day at this point is scheduled for June 14th, and that's day 170 for students. As you recall, the governor did set the minimum number of days for students at 170, not 175 for this year.
Great. Thank you. Could we have a motion, please, to authorize the superintendent to have a half day of school on June 14th, the last day of the year, in order to prepare for graduation.
So moved.
Oh, lots of excitement on that one. Thank you, Liz and Michelle. I'll let Wendy sort out who did what. Thank you. Moved and seconded to declare a half day on June 14th. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, we have scheduled a half day for the 14th.
So we will announce that this week in our parent update in that news that we have our official last day thus penciled into the books.
That's one of the few things you've been able to actually schedule.
It's not incredible.
We'll probably have a snowstorm and we won't be able to do it.
Yep. So the biggest stars of the night though are Green Street and Dummerston schools. And I don't want to take any further time to take away from their presentations. Julian and Mark, both I know have worked with their leadership teams to give you a snapshot of some of the great things taking place in their schools. And so I'm going to turn over the time to them and we'll defer to their work. Mark and Julian, I'm not sure how you want to roll out the order for this. I'll step back and let you guys figure out who wants to go first.
Who wants to go first? I can go first.
Sure.
Okay. All right. Thank you, everybody, for the opportunity to talk about our schools. I'm just going to jump right in because I know we want to make the best use of time. So I'll share my screen. We have some slides to share with you. And then we have some staff members here as well. So we're just gonna get right into it. Let me move my things around here. So the leadership team talked about what we wanted to share with you tonight. And we wanted to spend some time talking about our social, emotional, and academic learning framework at Dummerston School. And what's going on with it currently, because it has been something that we've been really focused on since prior to the pandemic, which was my first year last year as Dummerston School principal. And we've been heavily focused on it this year and plan to be for years to come. Prior to the pandemic, the leadership team was meeting and looking at a variety of data. We were looking at our, of course, our academic proficiency data, our school climate data, our family surveys, and there was a lot to be proud of, but we were concerned about a few indicators that I would really put under the umbrella of student attachment to school and students, you know, feeling really deeply engaged in their work and their life at school. So we talked about how we wanted to respond to that data. We want 100% of Dummerston School students to feel deeply connected to their school community, to feel like they want to come to school every single day, to feel valued here, to feel like they're integrated into our community and deeply connected to both the curriculum and all of the individuals here. So, we looked at a few approaches and we landed on implementing developmental designs at our school. And there were a few reasons for that. One is that it already is in use at our district and Brattleboro Area Middle School, where I taught for years, has been using what we call DD for many years. I was trained in DD as a BAMS teacher, probably 8 or 9 years ago or longer. And it was a really important formative experience for me as an educator. It is a K-12 program, or we've adapted it actually to become a pre-K-12 program. And so that was really important because we have such a vast age span as a pre-K-8 school. We need programming that speaks to all of those different age ranges. And it's also very connected to responsive classroom, which is another program many people have used or have heard of, and many Dummerston School teachers were trained in responsive classrooms, so it dovetailed well with that. I think most importantly though, it was really the philosophy of DD and the foundational elements that really aligned with our values and our beliefs about students and about student learning. I wanna highlight that DD is not a set of prescribed lessons. It is not prescribed content. It is not a set curriculum. It's a framework for learning. It's a container that holds a number of best practices for instruction that many of us were already using, but we just needed a way to bring those together and to have common vocabulary and to really have an opportunity to focus explicitly on these foundational practices that make a real difference in the lives of students. The foundation of development designs that was so resonant with us is this idea that there are four elements that need to be in place in a learning environment for students to feel safe taking the risk to learn deeply, because that is always a risk. Learning is going out into the unknown, and so there's always a risk there. But the four elements apply not only to students, but they apply to all of us as adults as well. That, you know, in order to learn, in order to take safe risks to learn, we need relationship because we want to connect to other people. We need a sense of autonomy, knowing we can make choices and have a certain level of independence. We want to be challenged and we want to feel competent. So we want to feel successful and feel worthwhile and significant in our school community and in any community we exist in. And we want to have fun. We want to have a good time. And, you know, our brains are hardwired to want that and to need that. And when we plan and we design a school environment that has those elements in place, we will have an environment that is primed for student learning. So that that really dovetailed well with really what our beliefs already were as a staff. So then the pandemic hit. And so we had been planning on having a core leadership group go to DD training over the summer in person. We still did that, but it was virtual. And so we had representatives from each age range, grade cluster within our school, as well as different people in different roles take the virtual training of DD at the middle and elementary level. I forgot to mention the other reason DD was attractive is that I knew from talking to Steve Perrin that there were high school staff and teachers also doing the high school version of DD. So it seemed to be like a really good time to jump into this. We decided, you know, with the pandemic, we're at the beginning phases of implementing DD. So we focused on three elements of it. One is the morning circle. All of our students, pre-K to eight, experiencing a morning circle that has a specific routine associated with it. The loop, what DD calls the loop, which is a reflective cycle for students that permeates all of their experiences during the day, and then the social contract. And we wanted to drill down tonight a little bit into the social contract so you can see what that's all about. So part of the DD experience is that students create social contracts, which are essentially their agreement with each other about what they need and what they can give to each other in order to ensure that they have a learning community where they feel included and safe. And so one of the things students started working on right away at the beginning of the year was developing social contracts at the classroom level. So you can actually see here's some middle school social contracts. The teachers facilitated some very specific activities that were designed to get students thinking deeply about what was needed in their classroom community. And you can see how much there is overlap. Here's a grade 2-3. The students produce this together and go through a process of adopting it. Here's some more middle school social contracts. And here's what it looks like. Here's kindergarten and first grade. And I actually, our first grade teacher, Beth Montgomery, is here and was going to talk a little bit about making the social contract at the first grade level.
Okay. Hi, everybody. So doing a social contract in the middle of a pandemic was a really interesting experience. So I started the year with about 13 first graders. And they were split into two separate classes. So I had half Monday, Tuesday, and half Thursday, Friday. So this made the process a little more interesting because we still wanted to have a social contract that covered all of first grade with the hope that we would, as we did, come back together. So we began, as Julianne said, began the process by thinking about what would make our learning environment feel safe and inclusive. And to get them thinking about it, we read a few choice read alouds. The book Swimmy by Leo Leone was a great one because it talks about teamwork and how we all need each other. In the past years, I've always created a class set of rules. But this year I had to kind of let go of my idea of what the class rules should be and really just put it into the hands of the students. And so we basically just got out chart paper and I started writing down their ideas and any idea they came up with. And I did this with both of my classes. So I had two big charts. So it was great. They love, you know, to name things such as, you know, make sure we share, use kind words, make sure our bodies are safe on the playground. They also are really funny because they love to tell you what you should not do. So we had lots of don'ts, like don't bite, don't hit, like all of these different, don't jump down the slide. And so it was really interesting just talking about how to reframe some of those also as kind of a positive guidance. As opposed to being using the word don't. So that was a great conversation. So after we generated these lists, which also were very heavy with safety rules, and because we were making, you know, maintaining distance and wearing masks, and you know, we weren't crowded around on the rug in a circle the way we usually would be. So school felt a little different. And so I feel like some of that was reflected in our brainstorming. But the incredible part was when, after I did this with both of the groups, the lists were pretty close to identical. They had hit on, except for maybe don't bite, not everybody had that one, but they had all of those same big concepts. And so I went through with a marker and I circled like things that touched on being kind or touched on things of ways to be safe. And I did those in the same color and different colors to help them stand out to the first graders. And then we compared both lists. And again, we did this twice because I had to do it with each of my classes. And so then the tricky part came to kind of thinking about how could we take those common ideas and break it down into up to, we tried to keep it like below five, just really positive, simple ways to remind us of these ideas. And so in the end, we were able to get down to, as you can see in the first grade contract, to be safe, be kind, be a team, be honest, and follow directions. And the next step, once we kind of whittled that down, we had to all vote on if we like agreed. And so we love to use thumbs. So thumbs up was like, yes, this is awesome. I can do it. Sideways thumb was, oh, this could be hard, but I'll try. And then downwards thumb was like deal breaker, like can't do it. And so each one we voted. And so again, we did this two times, but it was interesting because it was overwhelmingly thumbs up. They, you know, it came from them. It was first, it was relevant and they created it. And there was only like one sideways thumb with be honest. And they were just like, I will try. And I was like, okay, awesome. That's all we can do. And so this, and then we all signed our names and onto like a formal version. And so it hangs on the wall in the classroom. And it's a really wonderful way as our day is going, if something comes up, we can be like, oh yeah, remember, let's be safe. Or, hey, is that being kind? And so it's just keeping it so simple makes it really easy for the kids to remember. And then, like I said, to just pull it out, like whether you're at recess or in the forest or in the middle of a math lesson. So it's been actually really, but I feel like much more powerful this year because of the fact that they created it. So that's how our class created ours. And I'm going to turn it back over to Julianne because that was just the first step in the social contract.
Great. Thank you, Beth. My internet just froze. So sorry if I go blank for a second, but I think I'm back. Thanks, Beth. So as Beth mentioned, the next step is actually having students come together, representatives from each classroom, to create a school-wide social contract. And so that was the task of Erica Garnett, who's our school counselor, who facilitated that process. And she is here tonight and just going to talk a little bit about what that was like, working with such a wide age span on that task.
Thanks, Julianne. Hi, everyone. So I basically collected all of the contracts that were done by each classroom. And I broke them apart. I did pre-K to four and fifth to eighth. So then what I ended up doing was I had a Zoom meeting and I invited the pre-K to four representatives to start off. And I did Padlet and I kind of arranged, you know, every single contract from every single classroom from pre-K to four. So there were many different agreements. Like Beth had showed, she had five in her classroom. You know, there's about three per each classroom. So there were quite a few of them and quite a few, you know, repeats on that screen. Granted, with a pre-K to four audience, not everyone can read. So there was definitely some adult support and intervention on that Zoom. But it was really interesting and really, really nice to see like the fourth graders and the third graders stepping in. I called on the fourth and third graders, like, oh, can you read that point out loud for our friends who can't read? So it was a really nice place to see a lot of leadership among the older elementary students. So basically what we did was, you know, all the students talked together, like, oh, I see we have be kind five times. Maybe be kind is a really important one that a lot of classrooms are thinking about. So I tried to gently facilitate that. I really wanted, like Beth and Julianne were saying, it to be really student focused and kind of increase that ownership. So kind of letting students arrive at, oh, be kind should definitely be, you know, one of our points. So what that pre-K to four team did with all those representatives and myself is we consolidated all of those social contract agreements down to three. And then that list of three traveled into the fifth to eighth grade Padlet Zoom as well. And that was definitely, you know, a slightly more developmentally advanced conversation, obviously. But it was, again, it was a really, really nice process that was almost entirely student facilitated. Like I had, you know, already alluded to, I really was intentional about being hands off and I wanted the students to really feel that ownership, like they were the ones, you know, creating these agreements. And it was just really nice to kind of observe and listen to the process of them actually deliberating, like, you know, giving each other feedback in the moment, being like, oh, I really like your idea. But like, or, and like, what about this? So it was just, it was really nice to see them like thoughtfully engage with one another and really take ownership over the contract. So, you know, coming out of that meeting, our three agreement social contract was born, which is what you have in front of you right now. So have a positive attitude and be friendly, respect everyone's physical and emotional safety, and be clean, safe, and organized. So those are our three overarching Dummerston school rules. And in Julianne's presentation later, you'll see where they're displayed in the building. So that was kind of what came out of this great process.
Thank you, Erica. So in a normal year, that social contract then becomes a center point, right, for all school meetings. You know, you're really acknowledging students and everything they're doing to follow the social contract. There's a, you know, would typically be like a pretty significant signing ceremony that involves all the students in the school. We couldn't do that in the pandemic year. One thing we did do was have teachers send photos and work with their students to create some photos that showed students embodying the social contract. And so I'll just show you some of that, you know, a little bit of a slideshow of what we pushed out to kids and families back in the fall after this social contract was adopted. So this is on the wall of our school in the main hallway. And so masking and things like that were really on students' minds, obviously, in the beginning of the year as a way of showing caring for each other and the distancing as a way of showing caring and respecting safety. Whoops, you don't have to watch it again. so, you know, I think we, in terms of the feelings that students have about it, you know, students talked a lot. Erica actually worked with students, her asset team, you know, and really embodying the social contract, and the asset team is our middle school leadership team. And just, you know, here are some things that those students talk about when they think about the social contract. So much of the work of being a learning community is around that sense of trust with each other, and the depth of that trust. And part of DD is really setting kids up to experience success in that. The idea that students can know that I know what I need to do to be trusted and I can trust others has been, I think, really significant, particularly in a year where there has been so much stress just for all of us, you know, living through a very difficult experience. I also just wanted to mention again that developmental design is not just about students and teachers. It is about the whole school community and everybody who interacts with the school community, including families and neighbors and everybody who is considered a part of this vast community that we have. One of the things that happened this year that was gave us so much hope is that even though we were, you know, the pandemic totally disrupted our routines and our relationships, but it also created these opportunities for us to interact with families and the community in new ways, and some very deep ways that expanded our relationship. And I think that's a common theme throughout the district when you talk to teachers. We had a group of parents who created a trail system that can be biked on and hiked on in our woods. And I'm not going to be able to show you this whole video, but just to give you a glimpse of what it looks like, this trail was dug out by hand by parents last spring during the pandemic and then unveiled to the community in August. And so it is a half mile of sort of switchback trails that go through a very steep section of our forest. And it has opened up so much opportunity and so many of those elements that we're looking for in terms of the DD foundational approach. I just wanted to give Hannah Van Loon a chance to talk for just a little bit. She's our pre-K pair educator and has been really accessing, we've been accessing this whole other space in our environment that we didn't access before. And Hannah was just gonna speak for just a little bit about that.
Thank you, Julianne. Hello, everyone. Yeah, we have definitely, when I say we, not just the pre-K, but the entire Dummerston School has really utilized these wonderful trails. You know, they've become outdoor learning spaces, you know, in many ways. And many hikes that I've been up, I've seen middle school students out there writing, sitting by a tree. You know, the Beth who spoke earlier, she takes her students up there often, daily, and has an outdoor learning space there. It's the trails provide many science opportunities, you know, seasons and nature changes, and the Beak program with Joan Carey, she comes, uses the trails often with students with her program. And the trails have just really opened up so many opportunities with all the students and all of the staff too. We always, the pre-K walks by and we wave to students and other staff as we go by, and it's just a wave, but it's a connection. It's part of that hello and the social part. And what a really great highlight and opportunity that the trails did for us was that we held our pre-K conferences, parent conferences, actually on the trail. We have a spot. There are spots. Beth has a spot, but pre-K has a spot. And Molly Oglesby and I were like, wait, we have the trails. The weather's beautiful. Let's do the parent conferences outside. Let's, you know, be a little different. So the wonderful thing was we were able to use them. And prior to the parent conferences, the students were, we were looking at maps and different ways of where maps are in our world, you know, not just in an atlas, not just a roadmap. And the students actually drew maps of the trail system or the trails that we've been using. And they used those maps to bring their parents up to a spot and showed what our spot and talked about what we do every day when we hike and what we see and things like that. And it was just a great way to bring the family, our parents, to actually see the place and what we do up there. They've been a chance to extend the learning in the classroom to learning in the woods and learning on the trails. We had a winter solstice celebration up there and about light. We had pumpkins donated to us and we had this great time of and harvest, but we had pumpkins painted along the trail and students were interacting and having fun with that. And it's just been, you know, we're all in our little pods at Dummerston and we're all in our little places, but the trail really opens us to be all one pod, to really all be one big community, learning with one another and being kind with one another and safe, you know, wearing our masks, distancing, all that. And I'll just end it with a very short story. It was before vacation for sure. And the little group of the pre-K and I and the teacher, Molly, we were headed up the trail and we often take buckets or little wicker baskets because the students really enjoy collecting something, piece of bark, rock, whatever. And one of the students, just as we were going up the steep part of the trail, he dropped his bucket and it rolled down the hill. And we all stood and went, oh dear, you know, and the teacher and I were about to say, oh gosh, that's too bad, or maybe we can go down and get it. And then immediately there were third and fourth graders, at least fourth grade, outside for a recess time. And before we knew it, a student in those grades ran over, got the bucket, brought the bucket, put it up on the hill, and then went back. And we thanked him, and the pre-K student who dropped the bucket thanked him. And the student got some applause from his classmates down on the playground. So it really has brought many great opportunities to our school. Thank you, Julianne.
Thank you, Hannah. Mm-hmm. So I know we have sort of two other, I get turn it over to Mark, and then we also have another short segment about our remote learning academy, the Oak Grove Dummerston Green Street Academy. So Mark, do you want to do your part next and then we'll touch on the remote piece?
That sounds great. Thanks. Great. So for our presentation tonight, Megan Altshuler is going to share her screen and drive the slideshow here. First of all, thank you for this opportunity this evening. We have decided to use this time and platform to reflect and share our experiences from the school year so far. During this past long summer of planning and developing our plans for the school year, I had been adamant that if we were to offer both in-person and remote instruction at the same time, that we needed to dedicate the same amount of energy to both options, and that it was our responsibility to do both very well. Embracing our challenge was the mantra we took on as a staff, which in turn has required incredible flexibility and trust with each other. I am proud of the work we have done this year. Obviously, we have had our many challenges. This school school year, and we can will continue to have them. But what have we gained? As educators, students, parents, and families, we've increased our resilience exponentially. We have solved problems we never dreamed we would have to solve. We have continued as a tight-knit school community, and we have embraced our challenges with perseverance. So tonight's PowerPoint is to show you some, just some, of the systems that were developed, data that we gained, skills that we learned, and examples of our resilience. And as we move forward for recovery planning and planning for next year, I cannot overstate enough the importance of focusing our plans and funds towards our most important people, which is, of course, the children of our school district. An emphasis on direct instruction and on the ground, in the school support for our students is going to be extremely important moving forward with our plans. With that being said, I do have some students for you to hear from. As many of you may know, Green Street School ends each school year with a spring tulip trot event. This year, of course, we can't run the event like normal. So we have created a combination of the tulip trot and a musical in one. So it's called the Tulip Trot the Musical, a virtual 5K cabaret mashup. So I have just a small sample from this production. It's about 40 seconds long, but it's an element of the story that these students will tell. And what they're going to be sharing in this scene really embraces the theme of our presentation tonight. So before Megan clicks play, I will want to add that on Saturday morning at 10 a.m., we will have a live unveiling of our Tulip Trot the Musical. It's about 22 minutes long. It's a fabulous production. I reviewed it today with Ms. Mo, who did the bulk of the work with the students. So if you can join us on the Green Street School website, 10 a.m. for the live event, that would be very welcomed. If not, the recording will be available later. So let's check out this little small little scene of a 22-minute play.
There's gotta be some solution if we could just embrace it.
Embrace it, that's it.
Like, embrace your fears?
Embrace your discomfort.
Embrace the impossible.
Embrace? Like, hug? You can't hug. There's a pandemic.
And we're on Zoom.
We can air hug.
Air hug what?
Technology?
Everything that's hard?
I have an idea. Let's embrace this situation and make the most of it.
We are always running for the thrill of it, thrill of it. Always pushing up the hill, searching for the thrill of it.
So that's a really small sample from the compilation. But as I was, you know, writing my intro for tonight, I watched this at the same time, and the parallels really struck me. So we added this little slide in at the last minute. But I will now turn the show over to Megan and the rest of the team.
Sorry.
I think we have Kaylee Sear and Tracy.
So I think Tracy, are you going to go first?
Sure, I can go first, absolutely. So one of the things that I think we're most excited about with the team I get to work with, because I'm the school counselor at Green Street, is our Tier 2 team. It began about 2 years ago as a formal structure for supporting students in our school. It was informal before that. Using the PBIS and MTSS model, we started the Tier 2 group to support emotional and behavioral needs for our students. as a PBIS committee, we realized that the process for accessing services, tier two services, needed to be streamlined and make more accessible for all kids and families. The people who work on the tier two team are our BCBA staff members. We have a planning room support person, Kathy, our HCRS clinician, our family liaison, the school nurse, and myself, the school counselor. And through the tier two team, we work with teachers, parents, and staff members to support kids who have unique emotional and behavioral needs in the classroom, at recess, in the hallway. It's our opportunity to really dig deep and figure out what plans we can create to help kids feel successful and be their best students and their best selves. We meet weekly. There's a referral process where teachers or staff members or parents can fill out a form. During this school year, in particular, it was really cool because on remote Wednesdays, we could have the weekly meeting and teachers could join us. So as a team, we would put together behavior and emotional support plans collaboratively, which is a really exciting process. And then we could check in a couple weeks just to see how is our plan doing? Are we seeing growth with our kids? Are there things that we need to change or tweak to help our kids be more successful, especially in these unique learning times that we were experiencing this academic school year? And so we're very passionate about our tier two work. We're gonna continue to do some tier two work next year. We're aligning to Vermont PBIS standards this summer to make sure that we're doing the best tier two work we can do. This year, in addition to tier two in person, we also had a tier two drop-in time on Friday afternoons for all our remote teachers because we knew that they were doing extraordinary work, but it would be maybe hard for us to connect with them. So on Friday afternoons, we just had a drop-in time. Teachers could come in, check in with us. We could develop mini plans, large plans, school connectivity plans, and then we would follow up with one another on a weekly basis because that was a standing meeting and we got to see each other every week. And staff members of Oak Grove and Green Street participated in the remote drop-in tier two time, which was really exciting because again, you know, the pandemic was certainly very tricky, but with Zoom and remote meetings, we were really able to collaborate and work together. And so that was kind of an exciting opportunity for all of us.
Yeah, thanks, Tracy. So I'm Kaylee. I'm teaching fifth grade fully remote this year with Carmen Winchester from Dummerston. But during the first semester going into the school year, I was really nervous about how I was going to meet the needs of all of my students from three different schools, many different lifestyles, all having different needs. And I began the year with 23 fifth grade students on my own. And it became really evident quickly that it was a huge challenge to stay on top of the needs of each child and each family. And like Tracy said, the tier two team worked really hard to put together these office hours, and it became an opportunity where I could just drop in and talk about every student in my class if I wanted to and how they were doing and if I had any social, emotional, or behavioral needs. I really think of it as if I were in person at school, I would pop into the step room or I would pop into Tracy's office and I would, you know, just troubleshoot and brainstorm on how to support a kiddo. And these office hours have really become a time where it's a time set aside in my schedule and their schedule to troubleshoot with all of the necessary parties at one time and come up with a plan. So just a little tidbit from a remote perspective, it's been extremely helpful. And I think helping maintain that school connection for students as well.
Hey everybody, my name is Bryn Tucker, and typically I'm an instructional coach at Green Street, but this year I have been the second grade remote teacher. I think it's the first time I've taught second grade since student teaching. I've taught for 17 years, I think. And I remember coming into the year thinking, how on earth are we gonna do this? How am I gonna teach 7-year-olds all year long on a screen? And our goal right now is to give you a little bit of sense of how that's worked. for a couple different grade levels. And I know that Dummerston will give some additional details on some of the projects that we've worked on. I will say I've learned more this year than I ever have in a year of teaching. I think I have closer relationships, ironically, with my students. I do stop by and drop off stuff at their house, but you know, I don't actually physically spend time with them, but I have this unique view into their lives and their worlds and their families and their cats and their projects and their bunk beds that has created this bond that's been very, very special. And similarly, the way that parents and guardians and grownups in the houses have stepped up to really communicate and support their children's learning has been a unique connection in terms of partnership with families. And it's actually something I'll really miss about remote teaching, I think, when we go back in person, and something, you know, there are all these little glimmers of things that I hope we can continue to bring back, kind of the best of what we've learned. We've had great connections. We've had lots of engagement and involvement. You're looking at some pictures of some of the projects our 7 and 8-year-olds have done this year. And I will say, in this very challenging and terrible year, it's the connection with these kids and their families that has kept me personally going. We show up to Zoom and I can honestly say we have fun together. We laugh. So it's been really incredible. So we'd like to give you a little picture of what it looks like to be a remote second grader. So in the next slide, we have a picture of a week at a glance for a second grader. And each of these underlying things that you're seeing here are live Zoom links that students can join for their instruction. This slide happens to be for a student who also gets special ed services and some additional wraparound supports. In addition to academic times, there are lunch bunches, there are live French classes, there's read alouds, there's time to come and hang out with grownups. There's at least 4 different grownups who help support the students in my class, and every single one of them is valued and needed and has done an amazing job with these kids. They have connections with everyone. So there's lots and lots of opportunity for learning, and there's lots of opportunity to be off screen as well. The next slide that Megan will show is what our learning pathways look like. So each week the students get a slide deck in my class on Google Classroom. And this happens to be the math pathway. There's always a literacy pathway and a math pathway and often some kind of theme pathway of tasks that students can do. And red tasks are must do's and green tasks are kind of get to's. And it's really up to the student and the family how they want to pace themselves throughout the week. And all of the opportunities for learning asynchronously that are presented here really align to whatever our learning goals are for the week. And as students finish tasks, they color in the boxes. And so it's a easy form of communication so I can give support and see how students are progressing throughout their week. Some of these are on-screen activities, some of them are games, some of them are on packets that I've delivered to students' houses. Some of them are instructional videos of me that the students watch throughout the week. And so they get some of their lessons that way as well. So that's what a pathway looks like for kids. Oh, Megan's gonna show what the website looks like. So many of our grade levels have these websites where we deliver a lot of our content. So this happens to be our math counting page. And these are little videos that kids would watch to do warm-ups for their math. And if you scroll down, Megan, sometimes we have students featured. So the students help teach each other as peers and help them practice some of their skills. And there's different tabs on there for literacy and math and our theme and information for families. So it's additional places that families can go to get practice and support for their kids. Megan, if we can go back to the presentation really quickly. I think, you know, the other thing that I would say is that it's this unique image into students' lives. So if you go to the next slide, you know, sometimes we have salamanders that show up on Zoom, and those are great learning opportunities. And we do April Fool's pranks. So this was a spelling test that we did on April Fool's. It's a little hard to see, but it says, "There is no real test. You were tricked. Happy April Fool's Day." And then the kids realize that at the end. We have a lot of fun together, like I said, and I really think the kids see each other as a community. They have connections, they comment on each other's work, they're very supportive of one another, they love going to lunch bunches, they love playing games, And especially in this year, I can say for me as a grown-up, it's very isolating to be remote and to not have that daily interaction with other people. And I think that's probably true for our students. And so I would like to think that our remote community is a real nice lifeline for a lot of these kids who otherwise wouldn't have that connection every day. We don't just have fun though, there's been an incredible amount of growth. So what you're looking at here is in the upper left-hand corner are reading scores in second grade from the beginning of the year. And then the pink line is the mid-year assessment. We've had tremendous growth with our reading. Kids have learned to read on Zoom. It's pretty inspiring. And in the bottom right-hand corner is one student's progress graph where we keep track over time. Almost 100% of my students have already met the end of the year second grade math target as well. So it's not just fun and it's not just projects. They are learning and they are learning deeply. And it's because of the partnership back at the home schools, the team planning that we have with the teachers who are in person, and the amazing work that guardians are doing at home that has helped us achieve this. Yeah, so that's a snapshot of second grade.
Can give you a quick snapshot of a little bit of a day in the life of a remote fourth grader. I'm Megan Altshuler. I, back in the olden days, taught fourth grade in person at Green Street School, and this year I've been the remote fourth grade teacher. So I did get to teach a grade that I have been working with, which was a huge benefit. And this is just a few little snapshots here of how assignments get pushed out to fourth graders, which is similar to second grade. So we have Google Classroom and they get a slide deck. And this also gets pushed out to families and support grownups each week. So the students have an at-a-glance, what do you need to sort of check off your list each day for your independent work and assignments so that they can plan ahead or look at the whole week and how to use that time. They also have a daily pathway. And so it includes all of the Zoom links that they need for tier one supports. Every student has a morning meeting as a whole group. And then I see every student has a small group literacy direct instruction every day and small group math instruction every day, and then independent work that they do as well. And then their independent work is in these big boxes. There's live links to a lot of different programs that we use and assignments that are teacher created. And then at the bottom here, there's drop-in assignment support time, hangout. We were lucky to get to work with a staff member at Oak Grove who's way cooler than me, who the kids love hanging out with. And so they go and they're like, you'll hear them at morning meeting be like, I can't wait to go hang out with Dan. Are you going to go to Dan's group today? Because he's more fun than me. And thank goodness for Dan's group. And then there's a read aloud to end the day. And those are all recorded and put up on Google Classroom. These are all optional. These are not have to's, but these are really just times for kids to either get academic support, connect socially, the read aloud is a great time to at the end of their day. And then each student also separate from this has a weekly schedule that is just their Zoom links. And so this is one student's weekly schedule who has a couple of different tier two or tier three special ed services. And so all of their links are right in one spot. So they don't need to go to different slides for each day. It's like one-stop shopping. And this is shared with all of the, you know, the three different schools and all of the different special educators that are working from the 15 bajillion different places can all get their live links in here and shift as needed. So I think going into this last spring when we went remote, I had connections with my students already. I knew them. They knew that I believed that they could do hard things. We knew each other as writers. We knew each other as mathematicians. And I was worried going into this year about how I was going to create those connections. And at first it was like, oh, I want to do all the tech things and do all of the fancy stuff. And when it really came down to it, building the relationships, whether you're on Zoom or in person, became what we did in our small groups, in our morning meetings. We had guests come and juggle, and there was joy and there was connection, and it was both the easiest thing and the hardest thing all at once each day to keep those connections. And there's a whole lot of, hey, can I meet with you right now throughout the day, and making the time to meet with students one-on-one so that they feel safe and comfortable all together, laughing and being silly and sharing their work playing games together. So this is a snapshot of, we as a school, as Green Street Community, have been working on building math non-negotiables K through six and tracking them. And we had done a lot of work in person on how we were going to do these formative assessments and be checking in on our math non-negotiables throughout the year. And so then taking all of this work that we had done in person, when you can't always see how a student writes and then answers something with their math. And this is just a snapshot of taking this in person, using technology to continue the work that we've been doing. And this, and Bryn spoke to this a little bit about being able to work with the rest of the fourth grade team has been crucial in continuing the work to build these non-negotiables and track this throughout the year. And so what was once done in person, we could then sort of use our systems and our tools to track remotely so that I could see, oh, like clearly I needed to go back and work on subtraction or the doing area at this point. This was earlier in the year, but it allowed me to see students' growth over time too. This is, these are not dates, these are like numbers correct, and how I could see how students change based on the non-negotiables for a whole year on a weekly basis. And so we're still doing real academics over Zoom and being flexible, and kids are seeing real growth in themselves. And the parents are also seeing a lot of growth. This is a quote from a fourth grade parent, and that I will leave this up here that you can read, and a video from a second grade parent. Should I just play that, Bryn?
Hi, my name is Carrie Newton. My son, Dawson Newton, is a Dummerston student in the second grade. This year, we chose fully remote for personal and family reasons. And we have had the amazing opportunity to be paired up with Green Street School. And we have been paired up with Bryn Tucker for remote instruction for the year. I was incredibly hesitant at the beginning of the year to see how remote learning would go. My son's not an avid screen time kiddo, and we entered these waters nervously. But under Bryn's guiding hand and the partnership between Dummerston and Green Street, our experience has been nothing short of extraordinary. Besides the academic personal growth that my son has experienced, his competence and performance anxiety has gone down also. We entered the year with him reading at like 26 words per minute, and now he's up to 81, 82, and almost where he needs to be grade level. And I think the reason for this, not think, I know the reason for this is that he's been able to work at his own pace and not compare himself to his peers. He's a morning kiddo. He's up at 5:30 in the morning. And by 7:30, when the rest of us are waking up, he has almost all of his work done. He's learned how to become an independent learner. through this. He's learned how to navigate technology, and he's learned that he is a learner and that he can do it, and that he's a reader, and that he's a mathematician, and that he knows that if he perseveres and he works hard on anything, that he'll get the answer. So that's been our experience. And I just can't say enough for Bryn and the amazing work that she has done, meeting us where we're at. It's almost like he has this individualized learning plan. He does, really. He has a pathway that he has to work through for literacy and a different pathway for math. And it meets him right where he's at every single week. And we just see and have seen and continue to see just this tremendous growth and blossoming. Not only has Bryn been amazing as a teacher, coming to our home, dropping off supplies, making that connection, the support teachers that have been in there in the class, Ms. Draper and Ms. Madison, my son views them as teachers. He goes to extra help with them for the Zooms and goes to story time with them. And they are his teachers equally. And also his classmates, the little community that they have built and how they nurture and encourage each other is just short of incredible. And last but not least, how here we have a little second grader who can feel equally part of Dummerston School, where he will go back to next year. He meets with his counselor once a week from there just to stay connected and to have that touch point, and how he equally feels connected to Green Street School and taking part in the Tulip Trot and some of their all school sings. I just find it such a blessing for us. And I know it's for us, and I know every individual has had a different experience, but for us, this year has been a gift to our son academically, that he's been able to just blossom. So I want to thank the district for their amazing work and the schools and their collaboration to put this plan into place. I know it's been a lot of heavy lifting, and I want to assure you all that that work has not been in vain. And for us, we are reaping those benefits 100-fold. And so thank you. Thank you very much from the bottom of my heart. And my son will say the same thing. He's so thankful for this year and how it's been a silver lining and a blessing to all of us amongst everything else that's going on in society and the world. Thank you for allowing me to share. Hi.
Meg, do you want to speak to what's been going on in person at Green Street School?
I can, yeah. So I'm Meg Chingeri, and I teach second grade, and I am in person. I've been in person all year. And so in person has looked different, obviously, as things have constantly been changing this year. And one of the things that has also been different is that we've had a lot of different staff move into different roles. So we have a video here that highlights some of the teachers who have had to switch positions and have done so gracefully and willingly, and the flexibility that it's taken from all of these different staff members to really meet students where they're at.
This is muted.
Oh, what this
I'm so sorry. My first time on Zoom.
I'm a kindergarten teacher at Green Street School. Prior to this school year, I was an academic support teacher for the primary grades. Last summer, I didn't know what this school year was going to look like, so I decided to join the COVID safety team to figure out how we were going to make the school year work. I knew I wanted to be in person, but I didn't know what my job would entail. Right before school started, like a week and a half before, Mark asked us what we might want to do if we wanted to be in school to teach, if we wanted to be remote, if we wanted to do kind of half and half. And I jumped at the chance to be in school as much as possible. That being said, a few days later, he called and asked if I'd be willing to teach kindergarten 4 days a week. I automatically said yes, was super excited, and then I hung up the phone and was like, oh, what am I going to be doing? How am I going to teach two different pods of students? What's that going to even look like? And I'm happy to report that in May, or when we're in April actually, we figured it out. I now have one group of students 4 days a week, which has been a little less challenging. Prior to that, with two groups, I was having some students online and some students in the classroom. Trying to teach and figure out how to teach both of them was a huge challenge, but we made it work with some help. I spent some Wednesdays driving around to drop off materials to all the kindergartners because we suddenly had to go remote. And as you know, they don't do well on computers all day. We didn't want to just see their cats for half an hour. Through all that, and with the guidance of the COVID safety team, my coworkers, and Mark, we've had a really successful year. Even though we're in 6 foot distance spaces and we're wearing masks and we can't do the things that we normally would do, this kindergarten class has had a really great year, and we've built a huge community with just our nine friends. I'm glad I took the jump to teach 4 days a week, even with all the craziness, because it's been a joy and a class that I'll never forget.
Hello, my name is Allie Bissonette, and I typically teach second grade at Green Street School. This would have been my sixth year. But in the summer, Mark called me and asked me to become a third grade teacher this year. Just because of teachers wanting to stay fully remote this coming year or figuring out the hybrid. Anyway, there was a spot in third grade and there wasn't really a spot in second grade. So I honestly didn't think about it that much because when Mark asks me to do something, I just say yes. But what the big draw for me was knowing that I was going to be with my same students and have almost all the same families as I had in second grade moving up with me to third grade. And that just seemed like such a wonderful opportunity for growth to watch them grow. And I also felt like it was going to alleviate some of that beginning of the year team building. And thankfully that turned out to be true because I got most of my students on my list were kids I already had, with the exception of one to begin with. So I already had a rapport going with families through all of this COVID change and struggle and challenge, but also had built those really strong relationships already. And of course, when the kids came to me, even though it had been months since I'd been with them, we just picked right back up where we were. So that was actually really wonderful, and I'm glad I made that choice. Of course, there were challenges, and that was that I've never taught third grade before. So I basically have to study every lesson before I teach it to make sure that I have it down and everything's thorough. And I try my best to prepare for the challenges of those lessons, although I'm still learning a lot every day. And I work really hard at that. So that has been the biggest challenge, is that when you teach a curriculum for so long, you get to know it so well. And this year, I don't know. So I'm learning all the time. But it's been an opportunity to tell the kids that I'm learning with them. And that's been really cool to see.
a couple of other benefits have been that now I've seen curriculum across grades. So when I go back to second grade next year, I will understand the benefits of what I'm doing, moving the kids forward, and that feels really positive. And the thing I've probably loved the most, aside from being with my kids and having these strong relationships, is that I've gotten to work with other colleagues that I didn't get to work with before. So I've built really strong relationships now with the third grade team, and that feels wonderful. So overall, yes, it has been a challenging year for everybody, and I faced the same, if not more, challenges. But I also feel like it was positive because I learned so much and I built some incredible relationships that I might not have had I not moved up.
Hello, I am Shannon Kelly. I have been the librarian at Green Street School for the past 5 years. And this year I ended up teaching sixth grade. Over the summer, things were very uncertain for many people. And as we started planning as a school to go into hybrid and fully remote options, it was pretty apparent that we didn't have enough staff certified in elementary education to pull off the plan the way I saw it. And fortunately, I have maintained my elementary ed certification. And so looking at the numbers, I knew that the right thing to do was volunteer to fill in as a classroom teacher somewhere. So I got in touch with Mark and let him know I was willing to do that, which I believe came as a huge relief. So he followed up with a phone call, and here I am teaching sixth grade. Prior to being school librarian, I was a classroom teacher for about 10 years. And this year has been unlike any other, but it has been extremely enjoyable. My hybrid pod of 8 students became really close. And when we went to 4 days and combined, we've just focused a lot on spending time together and community building and just seeing the students so excited to be together and be silly and have fun and learn has just felt really good. I work with an awesome team. So Caitlin Campbell and Amira Flesher have been delightful to work with. We've all just had to be super flexible. Every week it seems like something crazy has happened, but we adapt. Sometimes we have to change our plans 2 times in 1 day, but we've made it work and stayed positive. And most importantly, the students are happy. And that's the most important thing this year, in my opinion. So yeah, I guess that's all I have to say. Thanks for listening.
So I'll just echo again what Shannon said. I think that in-person learning has been very rewarding. And I think that one of the most positive aspects of in-person learning has been seeing our students and how much our students enjoy coming to school, being with their friends, being with their teachers, and having a sense of community within their pods and at school. I think there has also been this opportunity to really focus on tier one instruction because we have been staying within our pods. And so the opportunities to do classroom projects and to integrate science and reading and writing. There's been a real opportunity to just kind of stray from the curriculum a little bit and do these projects. That all being said, Megan, if you wanna go to the next slide, I think our biggest challenge for in-person this year is that we really took a hit with our MTSS model, we have a lot of incredible staff that are working remotely and doing classroom positions and supporting those remote classrooms. So we lose that support in person. And it's basically just watered down our MTSS system. We have no academic support teachers, essentially. So we have great strong tier one instruction, and then we've lost that intervention time. And I think that teachers have found ways to work around that this year. We have developed workshop models or menus that do in that have been able to differentiate instruction. But I think that it's so different from having interventionists being able to push into classrooms to provide that support and really meet students at their individual learning needs. So it's kind of one of those situations where you don't know how good you have it until it's gone. And we really felt that this year. So looking forward, as Mark said at the very beginning of this, it's shown how critical it is for us to have those strong new and tier three. We look at students are coming back to us next year all over the board, and we're really going to need a strong MTSS model in our recovery plans.
That is our presentation for tonight. Thank you, everybody, for your work on the slideshow. It's really phenomenal, and I think it really paints a picture of how incredibly hard people have worked and how much problem solving and flexibility and changing and teamwork and collaboration has been put into place on a daily basis. And thank you for showing that off tonight.
Thank you, Mark and Julianne. That was just really fantastic. And aside from giving us a look inside the schools for the first time this year, we also got a look at the remote experience, which no one really, I think, had any idea about. And just incredibly grateful for this view, and especially for the time, given the demands of this year, which have not relented at all, that you took the time to put together such an incredible presentation. And this is, I think, the fourth week in a row that we've had just astonishing insights into the schools and into the work that you all do and the incredible quality of it. Next week we have BAMS, and then the week after that, Academy in Putney. And I think we should just start all over again from the beginning, because it's really been fantastic. Is there anything else that anyone wants to add before I ask the board for their responses?
David, we have some work samples. Maybe we can just share the link, push out the link. We have some work samples from the remote learners to share that are in a slide deck. And maybe we could put that out as a link. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we don't have chats here, but if you want to send it to me, I'll make sure it gets to the board. And I'm not sure how we can get it on the BCTV screen, but I'll talk to Rich and see if we can figure that out too.
Thank you.
So board, I imagine that you have some responses. Emily.
Thank you.
Go ahead, please.
I just wanted to say thank you to both Mark and Julianne and teams. This was really amazing to see. And specifically, I just wanted to, I was really, really impressed by the remote work. So Bryn Tucker's presentation, which had the pathways and having kids do the asynchronous work and the optional work and see the lessons, actually reminded me, I used to be a Montessori teacher, and it reminded me a lot of a more Montessori approach, where kids are like gathering for certain lessons, doing asynchronous projects on their own, and then have like this really flexibility in their schedule to determine when's best for them to do their work. And the mother who spoke or was recorded and said 5:38 a.m. her son's up, and you know, he likes to do his work then. And that kind of flexibility is just, it seemed amazing. And so I guess I wonder, like, you know, you guys have put so much amazing work into this. And this year has, you know, produced a lot of innovation because we had to. I wonder what you think in the future will be taken from this remote experience and integrated into the in-person in years to come. Because, you know, I'm sure the lesson learned can be applied broadly and could improve our schools overall. So I'd love to hear a little bit on that.
I see Megan's hand up. Go ahead, please.
Really quickly, the response to that, I think for me and probably for others as well, is this idea of the learning pathways and building independence and the incredible opportunities to differentiate for students and really pinpoint what each child needs with those pathways. I can't imagine losing all of that work that went into that this year and not moving forward with that.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Other comments, questions from the board? I think you left everyone speechless. Jackie, go ahead.
Thanks, David. Not really a question, just a comment. I've kind of wondered this whole time that there must be certain kids that might really flourish in a remote setting without some of the social pressures and time-related pressures of being in person. So it was really nice to hear from a parent that they did have that experience. And just an overall, like, I wonder if that's something that might be that we could maybe continue for some of our kids in the future, which I know would be like a huge heavy lift and all that, but it would be tough to imagine kids that are having a really great year despite all of this dialing that back, which I know is similar to what Emily just said, but I just wanted to echo that. It's good to hear the kids that are having a really great experience. I thought that some might, so that's really wonderful. Thanks.
Thanks, Jackie. Other comments? Michelle?
Yeah, I also just a comment, just wanted to say thank you. None of this was foreign to me. Dummerston's my kids' home-based school, and all of that remote school, it's like a little triggering as a parent. I don't know how you guys did it. There was such a difference from last spring. I watched my six-year-old, who I was so worried about, learn to read because of the work that and the connection that was made through a computer screen. And I think something that's really remarkable that you wouldn't know unless you were a parent doing this is how you managed to go into the school year and alleviate the demand from the parents. And that's so important since so many kids have parents at different places in life and whether they're home or not are capable of supporting their kid academically. And that was the thing that impressed me the most, was that you just managed to create these systems that allow the child of all ages to be really independent in doing their work. And I enjoyed every second of watching this. I'm proud of what I've experienced at Dummerston, but it's really neat to see the connection because I've heard so much. I know that mother who spoke, I was like getting emotional with her because I know how valuable this experience has been for her. So I like applaud all of you guys for putting this effort to come and share with us. And I applaud all the teachers in our district. I'm glad that people who don't have kids in the district tonight are getting an opportunity to just get a glimpse of what this school year has really entailed, because it's hard to appreciate it if it's not right in front of you to see these pathways and just all of the incredible work and creativity that you guys are pouring into this to make it work, and you're succeeding. I really liked seeing that there was actually some data that we could see growth. It's easy for me to say, well, my first grader is learning to read, but to see those bars raised, I just have so much confidence in you guys. So thank you.
Thanks, Michelle. Other comments?
Just say I really appreciate those comments from all of you. I think Julianne, and I know Julianne and Mary would agree that we have an amazing staff who have, you know, put this together throughout the course of the year. And I think we've done a really good job staying connected and supporting one another. And there's been a lot of coaching within teacher to teacher and a lot of learning from each other and a lot of sharing. And I will tell you, these folks don't sleep very often. They put in long hours. And I'm not exaggerating when I say that. Throughout the course of the year, we've had to make adjustments and add to our remote school because we weren't happy with what we were doing in the beginning of the year. And we had to adjust. And we had to collaborate as principals to share resources with each other. And I'm really proud of the way that we've done that and how we've evolved throughout the school year. And I think it's one of the highlights of my career. And it's really mostly about what I've seen and what I've witnessed from these incredible educators. I'll never forget this year for sure.
Thank you. Any other thoughts or comments, responses? Well, I hate to move on. It was so, I think that, that's Robin and not Archie. I'll take a chance on that.
Hi, yes, it's me, Robin. I agree that it was really wonderful hearing what was going on at both of these schools. And it sounds like some really incredible and creative work was done, especially to figure out how to teach in a whole new modality that no one has literally ever done before for elementary school. I was just wondering, to echo Jackie's question, if there is any plan to continue remote-only learning next year for students who thrived in that.
Andy, would you like to respond to that? Or is that part of the planning at this point?
At the time right now, that this has not really been a push from the Agency of Education, and there's still some question around if the state of emergency is lifted, if that disposition to allow remote learning will still be enacted. So it's not a question we're really prepared to answer right now. Great.
Thanks. Anything else? Well, again, thank you. This has just really been brilliant. It's really fantastic, and I hate to have to move on. But at least we're moving on to emergency funding. So we'll go to the fiscal report. Frank, I think it's going to give us an ESSER update and a projected surplus, if we can tell that at this point. Welcome, Frank.
Okay, yes, thank you. just a really brief report on the ESSER funding. Good news is that we've received a substantial amount of resources from the Federal Relief Act. There's four of them in play. The first one I've reported on earlier, about $1.5 million, that was primarily those emergency funds that allowed us to reorganize and support what you've just heard tonight. The ESSER one so that was called the CARES Relief Fund that I had reported on. We did air quality improvements. We did a lot of PPE, and there was a significant amount of personnel support. And I mentioned four levels of support. The second level is called ESSER 1, and that's about $1 million. That's what I can speak to tonight because we have submitted an application to the agency of ed, and that's been approved. There's an ESSER 2 that the group leadership team is working on collectively with a lot of stakeholders. There has not been an application submitted to the agency of ed for that, but it needs to be fairly soon so that we can get projects like what we've talked about, the Academy project and other projects, under part of the state's review process. So we can report on that a little later. And then the fourth stage of funding is what you've heard, I'm sure, in the national news, that Congress did pass the most recent funding plan, which is providing another $9 million approximately of funding for our school system. That's called the American Recovery Act funding. There's been no release of an application process yet by the agency of ed, so it's really very much out of our ability to utilize, but it's certainly something that I'm sure we'll see a lot of engagement on and a lot of discussion, and it all comes back to supporting the work that you've just heard this evening. So maybe just a super quick recap, and Paul or Andy or Deb, if you want to elaborate a little bit more, feel free. But the ESSER 1 application I mentioned is $1 million. We plan on spending about 3/4 of that this fiscal year that ends in June, and then the other quarter of that in the next fiscal year. The types of investments, the largest one is in personnel, and it is for the maintaining our operations, which includes things like running the summer school programs and also a significant amount of coordination for programming. And there's also probably the second largest investment is in the education technology. You heard about how much we relied on technology to operate both in school and remote. So there's a significant portion of that for that $1 million, about nearly 200,000 for technology. And then there are things like, there's about $100,000, a little more than that, for personnel on our buses. That's part of something that we had to implement along with so many other operational kind of accommodations to address the demands of the pandemic. So there's a quick overview, and I'm sure Paul or Deb or Andy could give you more detail in terms of specific program investments if you're interested.
Paul, Deb, Andy, anything you'd like to add?
I think Frank covered it.
Okay, great. Kelly has a question.
So thank you, David, for letting me ask this question. So I'm hearing about all these different funding amounts from the federal government, and I'm pleased that we have access to some supportive funds. But I've been asked by a member of the public, if it's kind of confusing, and maybe other people it's really clear to them, but I think it's confusing to at least me and some other people. Is any of these money going to be helping to offset any like taxpayer? I think there's a concern about an increase in taxes. And if any of this money is in any way going to help offset the taxes paid by our taxpayers in the coming years, whatnot.
Yeah, that's a good question. And I mentioned the larger batch of money, the third batch that is the most recent federal legislation. You know, we haven't got guidance on the criteria for that, but in general, we're hearing that things like construction is an eligible expense. And from that point of view, that substantial capital plan that we have reviewed, and it's, you know, it's on our website. I do hope that we will see many of those projects being eligible for part of that money. And that will obviously, you know, reduce the local burden that would have to be funded at some future point. You know, as you've heard, the primary purpose for these funds is to support the recovery of our student learners and to support our staff. And you know, that needs to be the priority, obviously. But it is a significant amount of funds coming our way. So I would expect that will be part of the dynamic. And you certainly have heard that from Governor Scott. He's mentioned at a state level as well, how he'd like to see a fair amount of these investments being those one-time improvements that are really necessary. But also, you know, quite expensive, and that avoids the fiscal cliff that you may also have heard of. You know, where if we commit to a significant amount of fixed cost as a result of this new money, and then the new money is not available in fiscal year 25, you know, what does that transition look like? And we expect to see a fair amount of guidance on that fairly soon, but we have not received that yet.
Thank you. Any other questions or anything additional, any comments? Great, thank you, Frank.
Okay.
Next is the committee reports. I'm not sure which, I didn't look up to see which committees met this week or in the last couple weeks, but I think we may have some backlog. So I think we'll just work down the list. And I'd like the board to, after the next couple weeks, I think it's on the 25th, where we should have a report on the reorganizing of leadership councils and the new membership and the meeting schedules and who the chairs are. And I think at that point, I'd like us to talk about how we might be able to do committee reports on one of the meetings during the month and leadership council reports on the other meeting during the month, rather than doing them all on the same night. Because the so anyway, we'll see how that schedule works out, and we'll see how the committee works out, and see what people think, and possibly be able to make that adjustment and make things a little more efficient. So well, first, the leadership councils, any reports or any information people would like to share? Just raise your hand and we'll get started. John, with Guilford?
Yeah, the Guilford Leadership Council met on April 16th. But at this time, if Beth, I know she was here earlier, if she would like to give the report, I think that would be very appropriate. Does anybody see Beth?
I don't see your name, but Beth.
She was here earlier, I'm sorry. So anyway, we met on the 16th and there were 10 people in attendance, and it was a really good, I gave a school board report, and then John Gagnon gave the administrative report, and he spoke about how things are going to transition back into, you know, as the month goes on. Actually, I believe tomorrow is the first of the remote students coming back for the SBAC tests. And it was a good meeting. There is some talk about the CC for G, which is child care for Guilford, is maybe doing a another program in Guilford in addition to the Guilford School. So that was put in there. So if John Gagnon's here, it might be good for him to speak on some of the other things that were mentioned.
I don't see, I think John went to bed.
Yeah. No, I'm right here, David.
Oh, I don't see the, I don't see your name on the list.
Yeah, I'm right here. Says I'll be going to bed soon, though. I can assure you that.
Oh, there you are.
Yep. Yeah. Great. So thank you, Sean. The other item that the Leadership Advisory Council spoke about was creating partnerships with various organizations throughout Guilford, such as the Guilford Free Library or CC4G, which Sean mentioned, the Conservation Committee in Guilford, et cetera. And with CC4G, that is a local nonprofit that is interested in early childhood education and child care. And they are trying to establish and purchase a property and perhaps build a structure that would be devoted to child care for infants through children in grade two, I believe. And it would be child care for after school and during school vacations in summertime. So that's what we did our early April LAC.
Thank you, John.
And David, if I may ask, the Guilford Leadership Council is gonna meet this Friday at 1 o'clock again. So thank you.
Great, thanks. Jackie?
Thank you. We had a really good meeting with quite a few people on April 5th. Mark and the staff members from Green Street touched on already a lot of things that have been going on. But we did talk a bit about the SBAC planning, which was happening, and some conversation about whether whether we might return to 5 days of school, which we know we don't know yet, and whether remote kids might come back into school. And again, we don't know, but regardless, the Wednesdays are gonna be taken up for the remote kids to come in and do the SBAC testing. So it's not, it couldn't be a thing for us at this point anyway, but you know, people obviously wanna know what's going on. There's been a lot of great work with the Diversity and Equity Committee. All of the students received a diversity and equity book, or they're going to, I'm sorry, in early May. And sorry, I'm scrolling through the agenda here too. And the staff had reflected on some of the hate crimes that had taken place toward Asian Americans. So that was really good discussion about how some curriculum might be centered on that going forward. At a time there was a celebration about how well the tulip trot was going, and now on Saturday we're going to see how well it went, which was really wonderful. And a couple of other things that we touched on had directly to do with the leadership councils, because I had suggested, and someone else had mentioned it too, that it would maybe be appropriate for leadership council members to receive a stipend, considering that it is something that is mandatory that we're requiring the schools to do. But the overall feeling is that that could cause some confusion. Like before we could do that, we would need really clear defined roles and members, which I know we're just about to clear all that up anyway, but it was just something we talked about. And someone had mentioned whether we might record the leadership council meetings. And there was a really good conversation around the overall feeling from the Green Street Leadership Council would be that something like that might make it feel less welcoming when the overall goal is to be more welcoming. So yeah, we had good leadership council discussion at the leadership council meeting. And the Green Street School Gardens, also work is being done, kids are planting, and they're really super excited about that. So I think that's about it. Unless I missed something, feel free to speak up, Mark or anybody.
Nailed it, Jackie. We'll be meeting on Monday night.
Thanks.
And you're meeting Monday. Great. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Let's see, Liz.
Hi, Putney Leadership Council hasn't met, but the EES Policy Council has met a couple of times. The combined classroom at Mulberry Bush has gone really, really well. It's gone so well that they've opened a combined pre-K classroom there. So that's good. Deb was able to find some extra money to give all her staff bonuses, which I'm sure they very much appreciated. She had the refunding application is done, and I see that's on our agenda. They worked on the selection criteria for early Head Start and added, they do it on a point system, and they felt that it wasn't really reflective of what they were seeing. So they added extra points for family stressors and things like legal issues or substance abuse issues or mental health issues to make that fairer. There was some leftover funding, I think, for maybe ESSER or CARES that Depp was going to have an air exchanger put in for Bird Street because the airflow in there is so bad. So she's making good use of that money. The home-based parent group committee met, and they had a session with TD Bank about things like checking and savings accounts and what goes into a credit report that they were the parents were quite interested in. They've been working on what kind of parent activity to do, and they settled on giving all families, whether they're home-based or the kids go to a classroom, they're all going to receive a book, and I believe it's going to be on animal tracks, and they're planning to have an in-person event at Memorial Park up by the Kiwanda shelter, so the kids can take their books and go in there, and then EES will provide a bag lunch for families. And we did discuss the Governor Scott and the AOE is trying to move all child care and early education into the AOE. And they're moving pieces from the Human Services Division all over the place. So they're actually making more of a mess than what's already there. But the thing that they have not thought about, what they would like to move to have all the pre-K education in public schools and not out in the community. They want it all school-based. And we probably want to keep an eye on that. If they do that, then you're going to see child care places and pre-K places closing down because you cannot run a business based on the younger kids. The numbers are way off with staffing, so they could create a bigger problem what they think they're solving. And they had some new hires, which included some teachers. So that's really good news because they've been looking for that for a long time. That's it. Thanks.
Thank you, Liz. I know they struggle to keep fully staffed. Thank you. Ruby?
Hi, Ruby McAdoo, the chair of the Putney Central School Leadership Council. As Liz mentioned, we have not met. Our normal time was in the middle of spring break. But I wanted to mention that we have an event this Saturday that is a collaborative event between the Leadership Council and the Putney Central School Farm to Table program or Farm to School program, and also some area kind of community organizations like the Forest for Learning, and also a Rewild program, which is a tree planting thing that's happening in Putney. So we're doing a green up day, and it will be focused on garden, kind of opening up the gardens and also planting trees into the ground on the campus, expanding the orchard. So it's a really exciting event. We hope people will show up. Hopefully the weather's good. And I'm excited about it because it's an example of a way that the Leadership Council, I feel like, can help with bringing in people in the community that maybe don't even have a kid at the school. So it's, I think that it has a real, really good potential. So hopefully that we have good reports next meeting.
Thank you, Ruby. And Kelly Young?
Yeah, David, I don't know if now is the appropriate time, but I have a question for Liz on what she was talking about.
Yes, go ahead.
So when she's talking about the pre-K and the effort to try and get it into the public school, my question goes to whether Liz, her understanding or anyone else's understanding is that the push is to make that mandatory. I understand that pre-K can be helpful for many students, and I certainly don't want to, you know, to or minimize that at all. But I just want to, I guess I would be concerned if there was a, there was an effort to make it mandatory. I appreciate parents being and families being able to make the choice. And I appreciate the fact that there seems to be much more availability, but my question goes to whether Liz thinks that the effort is to make that mandatory.
No, I don't think so, Kelly. Yeah, I don't think that's the road they're going down. Nothing has been mentioned about that. And I don't think that's a battle they want to pick with parents. So, but they're certainly picking another battle, so.
Thanks, Liz and Kelly. There's been a lot of conversation about universal preschool. One of the problems, which we obviously have in this district, is we don't have classroom space for all of that. And it's an additional, it's a significant increase in salary from private to public employment. So I think that, I'm not sure how far down the road that planning is. The transition to put all the preschool under the agency is something that is being looked at, and there's quite a bit of resistance. Chloe Leary from forgetting the name of the organization, but she's written several columns about that. And I encourage you to just search for Chloe Leary and read those articles, and she has a really good perspective on that. It's really knowledgeable. Yeah, Kelly?
Yeah, I just want to say that part of my concern is that at this point now, it seems like families can make choices about one program will fit the needs of their child over other programs. And so I guess if it's being mandatory, hopefully that's not going to come, but I'm just kind of like trying to look down the road. But if it does come to that, I guess part of my concern would that families would have less choice over where their students.
Right. But I can offer a quick synopsis.
Thank you, Deb.
Helpful. So my understanding of what's happening at the state level, that there's been conversation about moving the Child Development Division, which is currently under the Department of Children and Families, under the umbrella of the Department of Education. And that, you know, that is a huge shift would be emerging of two very different cultures. And so the legislators are thinking about studying this, you know, designing a year-long process where they're really considering all of these perspectives. And I can say that I've been involved in some of the preliminary conversations, and parent choice is at the top of the focus, in that that's something that definitely neither of the two agencies want to lose, that they really value parent choice. And so it isn't all about DOE taking, you know, insisting that all pre-K programs happen in schools, but rather they would have sort of the jurisdiction over that. And there's been a lot of conversation about maybe leaving some of the pieces under the Child Development Division. And so it's a really big conversation. And I don't think anything is going to happen for a long time. So at the most, there's going to be a study to look at all of these different facets. But there's nothing to be worried about at this point.
Great. Thanks, Deb. And just a reminder to everyone that you can write to your representative and ask them for an update of what's going on and get a really and find out what they know. But it's always good to hear from Deb because she knows. So thank you. Are there any other leadership councils reporting?
Academy met. I'd love to invite Robin Morgan to report out if that's okay. Robin was in attendance. Emily wasn't able to make it that night. Is that okay?
If Robin wants to, it sure is.
Okay, I'll chime in too. I'm happy to, but.
Okay.
Sure. So our meeting, we first wanted to update the member list of the Leadership Council for the board. Should I just say the names or?
No, we'll do that'll happen on the 25th. The principals are gathering that. Thank you.
Okay. So the next thing that we talked about was the local motion bike trailer that John Sessions had applied for, and they got to use the bikes for 3 weeks, and there was just some sharing of like what awesome times the kids were having on their bikes at recess and the learning that was going on with that. And they also got volunteers to staff the bike trailer during spring break so that kids from any school could come and ride bikes on the pump track that was made this fall there. And they had like helmets and other bikes for everyone to use. And they're also collecting some bikes to be permanently housed at the school. And they talked about some other campus plans for the summer, about upgrading some of the stuff on the playground, and reminded everyone about our vote coming up. And there was also some parents sharing about some concerns about communication to parents at the district level, the short timeline for decisions about remote days. And I think that was about the remote days for the vaccination clinics and the struggles that parents had trying to go to work and figure out their child care for that also feeling like there wasn't a clear message about when if we would be returning to 5 days a week this year, or just basically trying to communicate and get answers on stuff like that. So wondering if there was any opportunity for parents to provide feedback about that. And then Kelly did share that as far as they know, it's gonna be remote through the end of the year on Wednesday. So that answered some uncertainty that parents had about that. And there was a discussion about what impacts might be of further COVID cases in the school, as Academy had a few, but that there probably wouldn't be anything reaching the level of like a lockdown again like we have next year. So, and then we discussed in our next meeting, we're going to work on creating a mission statement and defining our basically purpose as the Leadership Council and responsibilities of the members.
Robin, has the Leadership Council reviewed the policy?
No, I think that's what we're going to do at the next meeting.
Good. That would help a lot with your mission. Great. Thank you. Keith Lyman.
Hi, everyone. Been a while since BAMS has reported out, so I just wanted to share a few key takeaways from our last meeting, which was in early April. I am excited. We've developed a great core group of folks who are passionate and working with us in our Leadership Council. Last meeting, there was about 9 people there, including me and a couple teachers, but it was good to have a good crew. I gave an update at the last meeting. We are doing SBAC testing in the middle of May, and it just a lot of but we're doing the week of May 10th and May 17th, and then eighth graders have to take the science test. We have about 80 remote students as well. So, you know, we'll be pretty busy trying to arrange all that. We got to get all those remote kids, as many of them as possible, in and test them. What I am excited about is after that testing, we have a couple of staff members who are really passionate about outdoor learning and providing, creating, you know, exciting, fun opportunities for kids outdoors. We have a lot of staff members passionate, but a couple of them are going to lead activities with the support of staff. So after the kids are done with the testing, we'll spend the rest of the day. If we can get our ropes course ready, we have an incredible ropes course at BAMS.
I'm afraid you're kind of breaking up
with the help of Robert Clerk. Oh, I'm sorry. I'll do my best.
Maybe if you turn the camera off, it might not take so much bandwidth.
Okay. I switched to my phone just because of that issue. I apologize. So anyway, we got some exciting opportunities coming up. We're changing our schedule around so kids can start moving around with the new guidance. And that's a lot of work, a lot of logistical things happening there, complete change to what we're doing, but we're hoping to pull it off in the next couple of weeks. I do want to remind everyone that next week is Teacher Appreciation Week. If people have a chance to thank teachers, that's always a good week. And the exciting thing with our Leadership Council conversations is about creating garden beds at our school. And those are going in May 8th, and we're dependent on volunteers. So there is a sign up right on the front of our webpage. If people would like to sign up to help us, it's a Saturday morning, and we could use shovels and tools and supplies and just volunteers. So if people are, you know, especially elementary families who will be coming to BAMS in the future, they're investing in that opportunity. So we're going to put them in a very public place, the front, kind of in between the bus loop and the parent drop-off loop, and really excited about that. And there's some great work happening with our Leadership Council on starting gardens. So that's a quick update from BAM. Sorry about the bandwidth.
It was greatly improved without the camera. So it really helped. Thank you. Any other Leadership Councils? Okay, we'll move to committees. Anyone has a report, go ahead and put your hand up and we'll just work right through the list. I'm not sure which committees met in the last couple of weeks or the last month that haven't had a chance to report, because we missed a couple of meetings of doing those. Sean?
Yeah, the Finance Committee met today. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to be there by Zoom, but Frank called me in on the phone, and the Jackie and Michelle and Wendy and Andy and Frank and I were all there. So the biggest takeaway of the meeting was what's going to happen here and not too many minutes further down the pike in the Academy School. There'll be a motion that'll be made, and Frank went into detail about the prequalification of contractors. And I was able to attend those planning sessions. So the Academy School project is moving forward under the tutelage of Diane and Frank and Nadav. So, and that was pretty much, the other thing was we discussed Frank gave an overview of the changing the Dummerston to a pellet boiler. So that's going forward. And I think there might've been one or two other little items, but it was a good meeting and a little more difficult because I couldn't be there in person, but it was a good meeting. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any other committees to report? I know a lot of the meetings are scheduled in the beginning of the month, so I think that our next meeting will have quite a few. Seeing no more, we will move on to unfinished business. And a quick question. I received an email earlier that some people were not able to get from the link on the agenda. People weren't able to get to the policies to read them through before the final review tonight. Is there anyone who would like us to, if that was the case, if anyone would like us to table these until the next meeting so they can review them more carefully, just let me know and we'll do that. Is there anyone that feels like they need more time to review them based on not being able to get the file to open? Well, I don't see anyone. So we will go ahead. So I would like a motion to approve the D1 personnel recruitment, selection, appointment, and background checks updated policy. Can I have a motion to that effect, please?
Dave, aren't we going to need a third reading before we actually approve?
No, okay. Statute is different for us in towns. We just need 10 days.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. So would you like to move it, Ann?
So moved.
Okay, and could I have a second, please?
Second, Emily.
Thank you, Emily. Any other questions or further discussion about the personnel recruitment and selection policy? Seeing none, all those in favor, please indicate by unmuting and saying aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Seeing none, the policy passes unanimously. And the second is the environmental awareness and responsibility policy. This is a new policy that we've worked on for nearly a year. And so could I have a motion, please, to adopt the E14 environmental awareness and responsibility policy?
So moved.
Thank you, Liz. And second?
Seconded.
Second. Thank you, Sean. It's been moved and seconded to adopt E14. Michelle has a question.
I did have questions. And I'm sorry, I was trying to pull up the policy so that I can reference it correctly. But there were two things, and I had sent a message, I'm sorry, at like 5 o'clock. And I wish I had spent more time reviewing it to give more notice. But one of the priority numbers referenced a statute that I could not find on the internet. I don't know if that's what you meant by not being able to open something, but it was Title 18, 17, 19. And I could not locate, it seemed Title 18 jumps right over that number. So I wasn't able to see that, what it was referencing. And I was also hoping that maybe somebody was present that could talk a little bit about the priority that was focused on our educational standards. It was both, there was a whole section dedicated to it. And then further down in maybe restoration, there was another reference to education. I'm just wanting to know how we've counseled with our curriculum coordinators and how these standards already overlap, or if they might create a need for change, is basically my question.
Well, the not finding the statute is an issue, because we'll have to clarify that. If it can't be in the policy, if it's an inaccurate number. And
I will find the link for you. But
thank you. I wonder if it was
not tonight, but it's real. So I will find it.
I wondered if it was just a typo, because it jumped over that number.
Okay. I will check then.
Yeah, I wasn't questioning the statute itself.
Thank you. And let me ask if anyone, I see Tom and Tim are unmuted. Would either of you like to respond to the education quality standards and the new science standards question, or would you like, we can postpone this and you can prepare a response if you'd like.
No, I'm
now you muted, Tim. I don't either. I mean, I don't have anything specific to add on this one. It's this is the point that has maybe been gone over more than anything else in our original policy, and that's been adopted into this this changed one. I don't have anything specific to add to this one, though. This is no.
Well, I think the probably the best thing we can say is that it went through several revisions and took into account particularly the concerns that we heard from teachers and the curriculum coordinators. And those things were adjusted, and I think there were a couple of words that were shifted, but basically it now aligns with the work that we're doing and just reinforces it and points it out as a priority as important to the board.
Right, David, it's because next gen science standards include these things.
Right.
So.
I think more was made of this than was intended. Is more along the lines of that we, as a board and as a district, consider this extremely important to be in our educational curriculum. That's about it. It was kind of misinterpreted as saying, "Oh, we're not doing enough. This has to be changed," and that was kind of the miscommunication. It was more along the lines of saying, "This is what we intend. This is what we value, and we support it." That's pretty much it.
Okay, I understood that. I just know that was such a concern. And I did notice that words like age appropriate were added to allow flexibility. And I guess for myself, just because it was such a passionate discussion with so many, such a big turnout, and we didn't do a lot to the Communication Council, didn't do a lot to publicize this and make sure that people knew. I just wanted to sort of hear with my own ears that we had verified that we weren't, we're not like shifting curriculum, and that the wording that we're choosing to use does support what the current standards are and what they're already using, I guess was all. I'm just looking for that confirmation.
That was the main misinterpretation or miscommunication on our end that came across as if we were saying this needs to be changed. It was more along the lines of we support what's being done. We support this being considered a priority. And that's it.
Thank you, Thomas.
Thank you. Any other questions on E14? Andy.
So, David, I believe it is a typo in the number of statute that's referenced. It is the 1700 series in 18 VSA that refers to the green cleaning laws, but I believe it's like 1781 through 1784. But it's that 1700 series in that 18 VSA. It's chapter 39. So we can tweak the policy number that it's referring, but I think it's a typo in what we have here. I think it's 1781 is the reference that defines the products.
So I would suggest then that we vote to approve it with the understanding that the accurate citation will be included. So if Wendy writes that down, then we can go ahead.
Yep, got it.
Thank you. Any other questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of approving E14 Environmental Awareness and Responsibility Policy, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? We have approved the Environmental Awareness and Responsibility Policy. Next is new business, and we need action on the Academy School Project Prequalification Criteria and advertisement. And I want to point out that it's 8:30, which is not late for us, but it's still late for people that in this meeting that have to work tomorrow. And we will be having a meeting on May 6th, where we will be discussing in depth the design and the plan and the reasoning and all of the stuff behind this. So I want to encourage us to take up this motion pretty much as written and move on. I don't know that we need a lot of conversation about this part. We have a committee that's reviewing the work, and it's a technical motion that we need in the process. So I would like us to do this with as little ado as possible. Frank, would you like to talk a little bit about the motion? And if we need to talk about it, we certainly can.
Sure. So Diane Abadie's here with us as well from Stevens Associates. We've met three times as a committee that was created by the board at the last board meeting. Sean was able to participate in all those meetings. And the documents I had sent on Friday to the full board with that recommendation you have. So yeah, just to get right to the point, the motion follows through with the state board rule 6300 that indicates the board has to approve the criteria for the pre-qualification to our prospective construction bidders. So that's one thing. And then also to approve the advertisement that essentially is sent to prospective construction bidders. So the documents that we sent do comply with the state board rule in terms of the different types of questions that the board must ask, and then the submittals that the construction firms will submit to this selection committee. We're ready to meet on right after May 19th. This advertisement basically requires contractors to reply to us by May 19th, and this selection committee will review that information. If it's possible for us to make a recommendation to the board at the second May meeting, then we would, but it's more likely that we would make a recommendation, the selection committee would make a recommendation to the board at the first June meeting. So if we could just reserve those two dates as potential action items needed on the agenda. But that's the overview. You know, it basically complies with state laws to the next step. We are hoping for board approval on this tonight so that we can actually contact interested bidders and start the pre-qualification process. Diane, was there anything that we should add?
I think you've covered it fairly well and briefly, which is, I think, appreciated. Okay.
Very good. Thank you for participating, Diane.
Thank you.
Jackie, question?
No question. I was going to make the motion.
Oh, okay. Have you got it in front of you?
I do.
Go ahead.
Thanks. I move that to ensure school construction projects are bid through a fair and open process and bids are received from responsible and qualified contractors, that the board approve the pre-qualification criteria and advertisement thereof for the Academy Addition and Renovation Project as recommended by the Construction Bidder Pre-Qualification Selection Committee.
I second.
Was that Liz?
It's Michelle.
Michelle, thank you. So moved and seconded to ensure the school construction projects are bid through a fair and open process and bids received from responsible and qualified contractors, that the board approve the pre-qualification criteria and advertisement thereof for the Academy Addition Renovation Project as recommended by the Construction Bidder Pre-Qualification Selection Committee. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Any opposed? It's passed unanimously. Thank you. And again, just a reminder, on May 6th at 7 p.m., Thursday, May 6th, we will have a public hearing on this. And Andy, I believe, is talking to the appropriate experts to help with that presentation about the reason for it and all the energy improvements and all the forward thinking that's gone into this project and the thoroughness of the team's work. So that's going to be highly educational. I encourage people to come on 7 o'clock on Thursday. Next is the Head Start Early Head Start refunding application. And that is, Deb, do you have I've got a partnership agreement here. Do you have a motion that goes with that?
That's part of the refunding application. So what I'm asking tonight is the board approval for our annual refunding application. as well as a new pot of money that was just awarded to us for cost of living increases. So to your question, David, the partnership agreement that you have probably is the Mulberry Bush articulated agreement. And that, as you heard earlier, is something new that we've been working on this year at EES. So the refunding application basically is due every year, and it's to award our monies to operate from July 1st all the way through June 30th. And we talk about in the application, I am required to talk about our progress and then to look forward and to, you know, include goals and all of that, of course, in response to what's going on in our community and based on what our family needs are. So the only change this year in the program offerings is that we are now offering a blended, to as Liz said earlier, a blended model in collaboration with Mulberry Bush. So we have an early Head Start classroom that we're offering there that's a mix of early Head Start and Mulberry Bush families. And now we've just begun a Head Start model as well. And so the agreements that you have in front of you are a reflection of those new options. Everything else is, in terms of our delivery plan, is slated to continue as we have been. We have overarching strategic goals, and this year we added two new goals to our list, and they are in alignment with what's happening in our district. And those goals are that we will embrace and embody diversity throughout program operations, and that comes with many new objectives for the next year, and that we will utilize technology to improve agency operations and efficacy. And that really is a reflection of what we've learned in the last year through the pandemic and how we can rely more on technology and how that can actually improve some of our operations. So we'll be looking at that in the next year and, you know, looking at lessons learned and thinking about how we might better use technology. As an example, we have to do daily health screens of our young children. And that, as you can imagine, is quite difficult when you're dealing with infants and toddlers and preschoolers, and it's winter. And one of our parents actually suggested an app, it's called Bright Wheels, that actually was on Shark Tank. And a couple of other programs in the community have been using it. And so we decided to give it a try, and it's wonderful. The parents actually can partner with us and can do a lot of the screening before they actually bring their child. And that has helped to address some of the bottlenecking that was going on in the early morning hours and making parents a little stressed, worried that they wouldn't make it to work on time. So those kinds of things we're really wanting to take a look at. So my very brief ask of you this evening is to approve the submission of our Head Start and Early Head Start refunding application in the total amount of $3,045,161. And that would be one motion. And then the next one will be for the supplemental cost of living increase, which I'll stop with to answer any questions that you may have about the refunding application.
Just briefly, Deb, it's approve how did you phrase that? I don't believe I have this in writing.
Okay, the submission of our Head Start and Early Head Start refunding application. In the amount of.
Yeah, I got that part.
Okay.
It's all the words. I got the number, so I didn't get the words.
Okay,
so I'm gonna read this slowly so Wendy can hopefully get it down, and then I'll ask for a motion. And we'll get the motion in the second, and then I'll take Kelly's question, if that's okay, Kelly. So could I have a motion, please, to approve the submission of the Head Start and Early Head Start refunding application in the amount of $3,450,161.
It's actually
$3,045,161. Okay. Well, I tried to get you an extra, you know,
$350. Well, we can give it a try and see what happens.
Okay, so it's $3,045,161.
Yep.
Okay. So moved, David.
Thank you, Liz. And could I have a second, please?
Second.
Not sure who that was. Tim?
Yeah.
Yep, great. Moved by Liz and seconded by Tim. Thank you. Kelly?
Yeah, can you just clarify where that funding is coming from? By saying refunding, it sounds, I mean, is it coming from the tax?
No. It's federal Head Start and Early Head Start funds that comes from the federal government.
And it's not a refund. It's refunding
funding
system.
So you're asking for essentially a pass through. We've gotten the money and you're asking us to pass it through to you.
No, it's a continuation. Every year we have to apply for continuation funding to keep our program going. And that's what I'm asking, is that you support us operating for another year. And the amount that the feds are allocating for that to happen is that $3 million figure.
And used to be under the Brattleboro Town Board. The Town Board was the fiscal agent, and now the district, the combined district is the agent. So we manage those funds, just like we do with the preschool funds. They come through us. So any other questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of approving the submission of the Head Start and Early Head Start refunding application for $3,045,161, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed?
I just have a question. Who moved and seconded it?
It was Liz and Tim.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And so then the next ask is for you to support a supplement to that. And that would be a cost of living allowance, and the federal guidance for that is that we use the money to increase salaries by at least 1.22%. And with the amount of money that we were allocated, we're able to do an across the board 2% cost of living increase effective with new contracts July 1st. So the amount that we would be applying for is $36,473. So my ask is that you support our submission of a COLA application in the amount of $36,473 to be used for a 2% increase for all staff salaries that are all Head Start and Early Head Start staff salaries.
So 36,743?
Nope, 36,473.
473. Okay. And Deb, would you, from being on the policy council, I remember this happened regularly, that money would be somehow become available and you were able to put it right into staff increases. Could you talk a little bit? Is that something that happens every year? It seems like it didn't. Just sometimes.
You're right, David. It depends on the whim of the government, I guess. Most years we do see a cost of living increase, but there have been some lean years. And way back when, you know, we were seeing higher like increases in the amount of 3 to 5%. That I haven't seen in a long time. But the cost of living allowance is based on the federal index, and we have been able to provide increases fairly regularly, I would say. And back in the day when you were with us, David, there may have been a year or two when we were not able to do that because the government didn't issue the money.
Thank you. I'm sure it's very welcome.
It is.
So Kelly, you had your hand up.
I just wanted to know if that was something that was just being done this year or if it was something on a more routine basis. And I think you already asked that.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, so could I have a motion please to approve the submission or approve the application for a supplemental cost of living increase of $36,473 for a 2% increase for Head Start and Early Head Start staff?
So moved.
Thank you, Sean.
Second.
Thank you, Ann. It's moved and seconded. Wendy, would you like me to read that again?
David, I'm going to read you what I have and tell me if it sounds good. So The motion is to approve a cost of living increase supplement application for $36,473 to be used for a 2% increase for Head Start and Early Head Start salaries.
I'm really glad you used yours and not mine. Thank you.
I took it right from Deb Gass. So
because
right,
I took notes, I didn't get it. Thank you. Any further questions on the cost of living for the Head Start and Early Head Start worthies? Seeing none, all those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I want to put up a special thank you to Liz. She's been a great addition to our policy council. We've had some pretty dismal levels of participation with our parents this year. Liz has been a dedicated, steadfast member, and she brings some great modeling for some of our young parents and how to behave or how to act as a board member. And she does a great job of bridging information from EES to the board. So I just want to extend a personal thanks to you, Liz.
It's nice to have somebody on your policy council that actually has a background in early ed, isn't it? Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Deb.
Thank you. Andy, question or comment?
I think that the partnership agreement refers to one from Windham Town School. I think that's that was the partnership agreement.
Yeah, that's next.
Okay.
I almost forgot it though. Thank you. So we are done with that part, and now we're on to new business C, which is a new pre-kindergarten partnership agreement, which I think will have some questions for us. This is, I'm going to actually share the screen on this one. I think you should get to see this. If I have it here. No, that's not it. This is a partnership agreement between the Windham Southeast School District and the Kingdom East School District of Linden, the Linden Town School. And I know you're going to wonder, what are we doing with a partnership agreement in Linden? But it's because one of our students is going to school there, is in their pre-K partnership, in their pre-K program. So we need to approve this so we can sign it and get it on its way. So any questions about that one? Kelly?
Yeah, so I'm wondering why the student isn't enrolled in a school district up there. Can you clarify, please?
Andy, the information I got from Barb was simply that it's because we have a Brattleboro preschooler enrolled there. Can you enlighten us? You're muted, Andy.
That's what I've heard about as well. I'm trying to access the email that I had from Janice on this one. I can't get the email.
I think Janice may be here. She came in a little earlier.
I'm not seeing her in the participant list anymore. I think we're down to 25. But she did email me as well. And and the student is attending remotely. And the way the preschool partnerships work is, you know, a kid can go from a given town to can go to any of the schools in the area. If they were, you know, sort of nearby, they would drive there. But in this case, it's a remote enrollment.
That's fascinating. Thank you. That makes sense. Kelly.
Yeah, it doesn't clarify why we should be paying for the student to go there as opposed to going to one in our, I mean, where is the student actually living?
I think they're living, living in this district if it's coming through us. And we're not paying for it. We're transferring the money through from the state of Vermont to the 10 hours or whatever it is currently this year, 12 hours of preschool support.
Okay, and so on a financial perspective, it seems like it's not a concern, but then this goes to like precedent. Is this something that we're going to have other students, other families who are going to say, well, this student got to go to this other preschool that is a significant distance away, and now I want to, my students should be able to. So, I mean, can you clarify why we should, I mean, I don't mean to be obstinate, but can you clarify why we should approve this student going to that preschool as opposed to one that's in our area? And maybe there's some other sort of factors that go into this, but why would we approve something such a distance away?
Well, I'm going to ask if I don't get this right, I'm going to ask Frank. So you were breaking up there, Kelly. So
the child is a Brattleboro child that moved from that town to here and is continuing to attend their remote academy. So they're now a local resident. It sounds like it's now a local resident and it remained in that existing program. So they're now in our catchment basin, basically.
And we also get some share of the administrative costs of managing those funds too, Kelly. So there's no loss really in our district. It's, you know, it's statewide money going to statewide programs.
And it also is, to your earlier point, Kelly, it's parent choice. So in this case, this is kind of the beauty of this kind of model. Parent, because it's remote, now all of these options have opened up in on a grander scale than we've ever seen before. And the parent is choosing to send their child or keep their child in the program where they started. And really, it's no loss. It's no loss to our district. It's passed through money.
That certainly makes sense in this, from what has been reported, that the student was there and is now coming, is remaining there remotely. But I guess I think maybe the board should just be aware then that if this may be an issue coming up. I mean, I would anticipate that at some point we may come up with this an issue related to this again. That's all.
Thanks, Kelly. Other questions? Sean?
Yeah, I would make a motion that the WSESD board approve the new pre-kindergarten partnership agreement as presented.
Thank you. May I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Liz. It's moved and seconded that we approve the new pre-kindergarten partnership agreement as presented. Any further conversation? Hearing none, all those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Any opposed? The ayes have it. And that's something brand new for us. Always a surprise. So, Andy, do we have any need for executive session?
Yes, and student matter, sorry.
David?
Okay. Yes, Tim.
Before we do that, on the agenda under admin business, there's a Morris Gannon training date.
Yes.
Did I miss that?
Yes, you did. Andy has been in touch with them, and they're going to schedule a sort of combined session in August, and then the others through September and October.
Sorry, I did miss it. Okay.
That's okay. No, it's good to get up to date. Okay, so I need a motion to move into executive session on a student matter where premature public knowledge would put the district and the persons at a distinct advantage.
So moved.
Thank you, Sean. Can I have a second?
Seconded.
So we will, all those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, we will be in executive session in a moment. I need to remove some people and put Wendy and Rich in the waiting room. And Andy, will we need action after this?
We may need action after this.
Okay, we may need action, and we're inviting the superintendent to join us. So I'm going to send Wendy to the waiting room, and Rich Melanson to the waiting room. Liz? No, Ann. Ann, thank you, Ann. Moved by Sean, seconded by Ann to accept the administration's proposal as presented. We can't discuss it. So all those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion is passed. And we have done our business, and it's 9:16, which is really good for us. Anne, could I have a motion to adjourn, please?
Is there anyone left, Dave? Because you offered a second chance on public comment.
No, there's nobody with us.
Okay. Mr. Chair, there being no further business before this board, I move that we adjourn.
Second.
Thank you, Liz. Moved and adjourned, moved and seconded that we adjourn. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, we are adjourned. Thank you, everyone. That was
Thank one. You.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night, Wendy.
Thank you, Wendy.
You're welcome. Nice to see you all.
Night.
Night, guys.
Have a good night.